Okay, I hope I'm audible. I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me, particularly Olivier. First thing you said to me when you arrived, did you bring your bike? This is because I usually bring my bike to conference because I'm a keen biker. I don't know if you have like evil plans for me, but because I went hiking and I don't know what was your purpose of me bringing my bike, but okay. anyway, but still thanks for inviting me. And I'm glad I did not bring my bike. So let me first acknowledge my collaborators. So it's Marco Pellini and Ruben Doornenbol. I didn't put the names at the picture, so I leave it for you to guess who is the who is the first year graduate student from the Netherlands and who is the experienced Italian PI. I think it may be obvious. Okay, so I'll to some extent not talk about spin mechanics, but I'll talk about the coupling of spin to fluid dynamics, or you may call it liquid spintronics, but of a specific kind. So Garrett already had magnetization dynamics coupled to Newton's equation of motion. I will have, let's say, essentially spin diffusion coupled to the Navier-Stokes equation, which is the fluid equivalent of the Newton's equation of motion. So it's really essentially about converting spin angular momentum to orbital angular momentum. And this is quite common in a number of situations. And I want to, just by way of introducing this topic, give a few examples, which are kind of far from our field, if I kind of call our field, as let's say, spintronics or condensed matter physics. So the first one is one that featured in Nature on the front page last year, which is a heavy iron collision experiment. And this is done actually not at CERN, but at RIC. So not close by, but very far away. So what they do here is they have a collider, and they collide to, I believe it's gold atoms, onto each other, but the collision is not central, it's slightly displaced. So as these atoms collide, they basically the collision imparts a huge amount of angular momentum. Now this collision is very high energetic. Basically what forms is a soup of quarks and gluons at these high energies, the so-called quark-gluon plasma, and this behaves like a hydrodynamic fluid. And apparently what they see in experiment is that some of this angular momentum that's being imparted turns into fluid vorticities. This, of course, they cannot see directly, but they can see what's coming off. And what's coming off is actually preferred spin polarizations of the particles that come off. So they can trace what kind of particles come off this collision eventually. And they have sometimes a preferred spin direction. And they trace back then this preferred spin direction resulting from the conversion of this orbital angular momentum imparted into spin direction. And from this, they actually backtrack that this fluid has a vorticity which is, let's say, a million or a thousand million times as fast, as large as vorticities of more common fluids on Earth. Okay, so this experiment is really about converting orbital angular momentum via the collision onto spin polarization. So this is a fairly recent experiment. I think the first experiments of this kind, with this kind I mean converting orbital motion vorticity via fluid vorticity into spin polarization, were done in nematic liquid crystals. So they go back to the early 90s. And so these are liquids which have molecules in them which somehow have a direction. So these are the typical molecules that I took from this paper. And this is the cartoon picture. So this is really a liquid with these molecules immersed in them. And then what they do in this experiment, as far as I understand it, they take a bucket, well, probably not an actual bucket, but let's say a bucket of this pneumatic liquid. They rotate it, and then they measure how the pneumatic director, which is kind of the average direction of the molecules, responds to this rotation. Okay, so they convert fluid rotation, fluid vorticity, into a pneumatic direction. And what's important, and this will come back in a few slides, is that this conversion of fluid vorticity, so fluid angular momentum, into this pneumatic director, which is almost like a spin but not quite, is described by one parameter called the rotational viscosity. This will come back in a second. So the rotational viscosity basically, in some units, gives the rate of transfer of angular momentum from this fluid to the orbital motion of the fluid to the spin of the fluid. And this is what they then measure in this case as a function of temperature. Of course, I'm not going to explain it. The point is that this rotational viscosity is something you can measure with these experiments. Rotate a bucket, look how the pneumatic director responds. Now, one that in particularly motivated this work, although I'm not going to work on this specific system, is the experiment by the group of Professor Saito of 2 years ago. That was actually presented at the third version of the spin mechanics, the third edition of the spin mechanics workshop, as I recall, in Munich. So this is called spin hydrodynamic generation in liquid mercury. So the experiment, let me talk you through it, is quite intricate. So what is being done here? So there's so mercury is a liquid metal, which is being pushed through a pipe. And then since this, since it's a liquid, it has this so-called Poiseuille flow. So there's a certain velocity pattern. So the flow direction through the pipe is this direction, but near the edges, the fluid has to stop because it's stopped basically by the edges of the pipe. And so the fluid flow is zero. And then if you go through this, you see the fluid velocity increase in the center of the pipe. And this is called Poiseuille flow. And this flow has a certain vorticity. So if you calculate the cross product, let's say the rotation of this flow, you find it has a vorticity which basically goes more or less linear. It's maximum at the edges and zero at the center because of symmetry. And then this vorticity is like an angular momentum source. And via spin orbit coupling, it generates spin. It generates spin accumulation. So there's a spin accumulation basically that follows this vorticity pattern. So there will be a spin accumulation gradient caused by this liquid flow with vorticity. And then the spin accumulation, since it has a gradient, it builds up a spin current that flows towards the edges and then is converted to a charge current via the inverse spin Hall effect. So this last step is not of particular importance for my talk, but this is kind of an electric readout of the coupling of spin angular momentum, the generation of spin by vorticity. And it's called spin hydrodynamic generation because it basically converts vorticity to electricity. Okay, so in all these, so in everything, all the examples I've talked about, we have orbital motion of a fluid, vorticity, so this is Nabla cross V, where V is the flow of the fluid, to spin degrees of freedom, with the exception of this pneumatic director, say, but okay. And it turns out that this is described by a coefficient called the rotational viscosity. And this rotational viscosity basically tells you that the, for those of you who are experienced with hydrodynamics, so the fluid flow, the central quantity is a so-called pressure tensor. And this pressure tensor has an anti-symmetric part if and only if the spin of the fluid and the vorticity are not equal to each other. And then the angular momentum will flow from one to the other until the pressure tensor, the anti-symmetric part, is zero again. And the rate of the flow, again, is determined by this rotational viscosity. So this quantity plays a role in all the experiments in principle that I've shown. And now what I want to do is apply this to a different system. So recently, 2 years ago or so, there has been the generalization, the realization of not liquid metals, but of liquid, let's say electrons, meaning electrons that interact so strongly amongst each other that you have to take into account their viscosity. So this is one of the experiments by the group of Andrei Geim and Kostya Novoselov in collaboration with Marco Pollini as a theorist. So what they have is graphene-based devices. So here's basically the device with several contacts attached to it. And this the system is so pure that they can bring it into a regime by going to a slightly elevated temperature. They can bring it to a regime where the electron-electron interactions are so strong that they basically dominate all other interactions. So interaction of electrons with impurities, electrons with phonons, etc. And once you're in this regime, let's say the hydrodynamic regime or fluid-like regime, whatever you want to call it, you have to take into account viscosity of the electron flow. So if you drive a current, for example, from this contact, the flow pattern, so these are now pictures of the flow pattern of the electron, calculated pictures, calculated flow patterns. So if the electrons would behave diffusively, you would get this flow pattern without vorticity. However, if you take into account the viscosity of the electrons, you get these flow patterns, for example, near this contact here, which have some non-zero vorticity. Okay. And so the spin vorticity coupling that I'm going to be talk about is the coupling between the spin of the electron and the flow of the electrons in these kind of setups. So not really in actual liquids, but in systems where the electrons behave as a viscous liquid. So the question is if there can be a coupling at all. If so, how large is it? Can we do some theory for that? And can we get to some predictions? And I'll try to answer these questions by first going to the phenomenology, then doing some microscopic calculation, giving some estimates. Then I'll give you one application of our theory, and then you can ask questions. So these are the hydrodynamic equation of motion that describe the coupled spin and fluid flow dynamics in a two-dimensional fluid with spin. So in this case, of course, an electron gas with spin. And so there are two equations, basically these are both linearized, to make it simpler, a Navier-Stokes equation and a spin diffusion equation. So let me talk you a little bit through both of them. So time dependence of the local spin. So let's first look at this term, let's say this eta's rotational viscosity times this vorticity. So here I'm talking about only angular momentum conservation in the z direction, so that's the only important angular momentum for me. And what you see from this equation is if I set the electron flow to rotation, I will generate spin. So this constant is positive, so I will generate spin by creating vorticity of the electron in the electron fluid. On the other end, this spin will also decay and can sort of convert into vorticity itself. So this, in principle, these two terms would like to balance out so that there's no net flow of angular momentum between the spin and the orbital degrees of freedom. And again, this is described by this rotational viscosity. So this rotational viscosity is kind of an appropriate unit. It's a rate that describes how fast the transfer of angular momentum between orbital and spin degrees of freedom is. Now, on top of that, we add kind of by hand also a spin relaxation term, which should be very, very weak. But in practice, you cannot really avoid it. And there's also spin diffusion. So even when the system is clean, so even when there would be no collisions of electrons with phonons or impurities, there would still be spin diffusion, because spin up and spin down interact with each other through interactions, and that will actually limit the spin transport. So even if the charge is completely ballistic, the spin would still diffuse if there are interactions. Okay, so this is the spin diffusion term. Okay, then for the electron flow, for the orbital degrees of freedom, we basically have Newton's equation of motion, but then for a fluid. Okay, so we have acceleration is equal to force. Then there's normal viscosity, so this nu here is the kinematic viscosity of the electron system. For graphene, it's about the same as honey, if that means something to you. And then there's sort of the counterpart of this term in the Navier-Stokes equation. Okay, so here we have spin polarization generating forces on the electron flow. There's also a momentum relaxation term labeled by momentum relaxation time. And another aspect of this equation which is not so familiar is that there's a mass density here which is, because the system is not necessarily Galilean invariant in this case, is kind of different from the ordinary mass density. So I'm going to be talking about spin orbit coupled systems, because you need spin orbit coupling to get this parameter non-zero. So that's a little subtlety here. Now looking at this equation, there are two important points for the rest of the talk. So first point is that if I would have a electron liquid without vorticity and I would create spin homogeneously, then the spin would decay with a constant determined by the rotational viscosity if kind of the ordinary spin relaxation is small, which is kind of the limit I have to be in for this hydrodynamic theory to apply anyway. And that gives us actually a way to calculate this rotational viscosity microscopically. So it turns out to be related to the spin relaxation in a clean system, a clean homogeneous system that is due to spin orbit coupling and interactions. So that this will be important later. Second thing is that these are complicated equations, but you can simplify them in the steady state. And in the steady state, there are basically three length scales that govern these equations. So out of the diffusive term, so this is spin diffusion, and this is essentially momentum diffusion, viscosity. You can build length scales that balance this gradient with this relaxation and this gradient with this relaxation. And then here you have a balance between the viscous terms and this momentum relaxation. So that gives three length scales. Okay, so I don't know by heart, but I think I have some numbers later on, otherwise I can look... I think it's gated, so, but I think these are the... I will have some numbers later on, maybe you can ask again. I mean, so I think for graphene now, this has been rather well established that, okay, this equation applies, apart from the spin, the coupling to spin. And experiments have been modeled, and this viscosity has been extracted from the modeling. So, okay, so there are three length scales that are important here. So the first is this so-called spin-rotation coupling length scale. So this is the length scale over which, let's say, the orbital degrees of freedom and the spin equilibrate. So if I create some vorticity, the spin will try to become equal to the vorticity, essentially, up to prefactors. And this happens over a certain length scale, which is the spin rotation coupling length scale, as we call it. Then there's an ordinary spin diffusion length, so this is the length scale over which spin relaxes away. And then there's a momentum relaxation length, which comes from residual impurities, residual electron phonon scattering, and this is basically the length scale over which any momentum diffuses away. So if I do, let's say, a traditional viscosity measurement, I would have, let's say, one fixed plate and one moving plate, and I would calculate the momentum imparted by the moving plate onto the other plate through the fluid. And basically, these two plates have to be closer together than this momentum relaxation length to see anything. And above that, it will decay exponentially. So the most interesting limit is the limit where the system is very clean, where these time scales, spin relaxation, momentum relaxation, are kind of very, very long. And when the spin orbit coupling is sufficiently strong, such that this length scale due to rotation, the spin rotation coupling length scale is the shortest length scale. And basically, it means that whatever vorticity you create, it will immediately be imprinted onto the spin density. Okay, so this is just phenomenology. What I've said so far is true for any electron fluid in two dimensions. So let me now go to some microscopics to actually see how big these parameters, how big in particular this rotational viscosity can be. So I said already the rotational viscosity is essentially the spin relaxation due to spin orbit coupling and interaction. So normally, well, for the ones of you who have thought about or even calculated spin relaxation, so normally you take into account, let's say, disorder and maybe some spin orbit coupling, either in the disorder or in intrinsic way in the band structure. The rotational viscosity is roughly speaking the same type of calculation, but then you have to look at the spin relaxation due to spin orbit coupling combined with interactions, not with disorder. So basically you have to evaluate the, for the experts, the imaginary part of the spin-spin response function, and then you can extract this rotational viscosity. Now to do this kind of, for now we have to make a choice for which model are we going to evaluate this. And since we are kind of the first to do this, we take the Rushby Hamiltonian, because that's kind of the Hamiltonian people always take as the first Hamiltonian, and it kind of generically models, let's say, a two-dimensional electron gas with spin-orbit coupling. Okay, so we take this this Rushby Hamiltonian ordinary kinetic energy, then as a strength of spin-orbit coupling, it's governed by lambda, and then there are electron-electron interactions which we're going to take into account as scattering time. Now here are the results of the calculation. So this is now a microscopic calculation of this rotational viscosity. We basically take two limits. So the generic problem is very, very hard. But we take two limiting cases which are easy. So the first one is the limit of strong spin orbit coupling. So this calculation, you really have to think about these results in terms of two communicating vessels, two reservoirs. One are the orbital degrees of freedom, the vorticity of the system. The other, the spin degrees of freedom, and there's communication from one to the other via the spin orbit coupling. And there's equilibration within each reservoir due to electron-electron interaction. So if the spin orbit coupling is very, very, very strong, then it basically drops out of the problem. So this will then be completely transparent. This will be completely transparent. And the only thing that then limits the relaxation is the electron-electron interaction itself. And then you basically get this result. So up to some constant, so this is the spin susceptibility, static spin susceptibility, you find that this rotational viscosity goes like the electron-electron interaction rate, which is inversely proportional to the kinematic viscosity. So let's say the diagonal viscosity. Okay, so the rotational viscosity is not a whole viscosity, but it's a different viscosity from the ordinary one. And in this strong spin orbit coupling limit, you find that this rotational viscosity goes like 1 over the kinematic viscosity, because the kinematic viscosity itself goes like the electron-electron interaction time. In the opposite limit of weak spin orbit coupling, you have basically the opposite result. Then you find that the rotational viscosity goes like the kinematic viscosity. Okay, and then, so in this opposite limit of weak spin orbit coupling, this is essentially a tunneling-like calculation where angular momentum tunnels from spin to orbital degrees of freedom. So these are the two limiting cases. The generic problem is hard. Okay, some estimates to see if this will lead to anything experimentally relevant. So these are estimates for graphene. I see actually that the density is not in here, on here, but I can look it up for you later. So the electron-electron interaction in graphene, so the time scale for those is 100 femtoseconds. These all come from this literature here. Now if you take graphene by itself doesn't have strong spin orbit coupling, so if you proximatize it with transition metal dichalcogenate, TMDC, you're able to induce a spin orbit coupling that can be this strong. And then if you plug that into results for the rotational viscosity, you get an equivalent damping rate of about 100 gigahertz. And then converting this into the length scale, the spin rotation coupling length scale, you find it's about 1 micrometer, which is comparable to the momentum relaxation length. Okay. So I said the interesting length scale, or the most interesting limit, would be this length scale, much shorter than all other length scales, but at least it seems to be able to get it comparable. So it's relatively promising. So from now I'll kind of assume, I'll give you one application and I'll assume that I'm in the limit where this length scale is actually smaller. I think I'm...
You have 7 minutes.
7 minutes? Okay. I'm nearly done. So let me now give you an application. Assuming now that the spin rotation coupling length scale is the smallest one, and there's an application where we calculate the amount of spin polarization that you would induce if you would flow this viscous electron liquid through a point contact. And so a point contact has been considered theoretically in graphene and also experimentally. So these are plots from a work by this author and his collaborators. So this is basically the electron flow through a constriction, a point contact. So the electrons travel from here to here. And then, so in this point contact, there's this, again, this Poiseuille-like flow pattern. So this is now the current density through this point contact as a function of this coordinate here. And there are a couple of curves. And these curves are all for different strength of electron-electron interaction. So the point of this particular paper was to show that if the electron-electron interactions are very, very strong, then the viscosity actually helps the electrons go through this point contact. And so what you see here is that from top curve to lower curve, you are looking at decreasing strength of electron interactions. So then you go from this viscous Poiseuille-like flow to a flow where the electrons flow ballistically and where the current density is homogeneous throughout this point contact. Okay, so in the viscous regime, which is the regime I've been talking about all along anyway, you generate vorticity in such a point contact. Now you can take now this flow pattern and calculate from this flow pattern what is the spin density that you generate inside this point contact if the spin orbit coupling is sufficiently strong. And this is what you get. So you get a spin density which has this particular formula. That doesn't mean too much. Here I plotted it. So this is now spin density in some arbitrary units. But I compare it actually to the spin density generated by the spin Hall effect. So what you see in the viscous regime is that you basically generate spin density throughout the entire point contact because there's vorticity everywhere in the point contact. And you locally generate spin density out of the vorticity. So I compare this to the spin density that you would generate in the spin Hall with the spin Hall effect in the diffusive regime. And then basically you you generate spin density only near the edges of the system over a length that is given by the spin relaxation length. Okay, and so if you compare these values, you also find actually that you can in principle generate a much larger spin density in this viscous regime. Okay, so the question that I want to answer is, can there be a sizable spin vorticity coupling in these viscous electron systems? I'm done actually. So I would say in principle, yes. Of course, it's experimentally extremely challenging because on the one hand, there is clean graphene where the electrons behave like honey. And with graphene doesn't have spin orbit coupling, so you have to either find a material which has similarly nice properties or induce the spin orbit coupling. But as soon as you start inducing the spin orbit coupling, of course, you also destroy these, well, at least you modify these nice viscous properties of the system. So ultimately, you'll be somewhere in between, but in principle, I think it's a nice challenge to put, perhaps, to some of you. Now, this can then in principle be used to generate spin densities that are large. It could be used to image the electron vorticity, which I think is kind of neat. And from the theory side, I think actually this particular system is kind of nice because it enables you to, in principle, study the crossover from this rotational way of inducing spin density from the vorticity. So as soon as you start adding this order, this will cross over to spin Hall physics. And to somehow describe this crossover, you have to take into account spin orbit coupling interactions and impurities. And in principle, that's a kind of a neat theoretical problem, which is then interesting, but it's of course also super hard. So I hope there are some people that are smarter than me in this audience. That's definitely true, but who will do this calculation? So thank you for your attention.